In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, Amen. Today, through the grace of God, we will study together chapter 4 from the letter of St. Paul to the Galatians. And the main purpose of sending them this letter, the Galatians, after accepted faith and became Christians, and although they were Gentiles means not Jewish, not from Jewish background, but some false teachers started to argue with them that you need to be Jewish in religion, you need to accept the Jewish tradition in order to be saved, plus Christianity. So they want to bring them back to all the Jewish tradition and all the works of the law. And St. Paul start to make argument with them whether we are justified by the works of the law or by the Lord Jesus Christ, by believing in the Lord Jesus Christ. And he explained to them that the works of the law cannot justify us. People cannot be justified by the works of the law. Otherwise, people in the Old Testament would be justified. But none from the Old Testament was able to be justified by the works of the law. And justification is only through believing in the Lord Jesus Christ. And he explained to them in chapter 3 why God gave us the law. The law was given to us by God. So if the law will not justify us, why God gave us the law? And he explained to them that law is to restrain the sin. Law is to discipline us until the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, until our justification through believing in the Lord Jesus Christ. And in this chapter 4, St. Paul continue his argument about our justification, and we are justified by believing in Christ, not through the law. So from verses 1 to 7, St. Paul explained that when Christ came, he redeemed those under the law and made it possible for them to receive the adoption as sons. So those who were under the law needed redemption. They were not justified. And then actually they were under bondage. And then the Lord Jesus Christ came and redeemed them and gave them the right to be heirs and to be sons of God. And from verse 8 to 20, he expressed to them his worry about them. And he described himself as a mother going through labor pain, and he was seeking to ensure that Christ will be portrayed in them. They will have the image of Christ and the likeness of Christ. And in the last 11 verses, from verse 21 to 31, he concluded his defense about justification by faith in Christ by making argument from the law and describing to us the two wives of Abraham, Hagar and Sarah, and how these two wives actually represent the two covenant, the old covenant and the new covenant. So the first 7 verses from chapter 4. Let's read together. Now I say that the heir as long as he is a child, does not differ at all from a slave, though he is master of all. St. Paul is saying, a child who is young and who is immature does not have freedom in his heritage, in his inheritance, but he is under a guardian and under a teacher, in order, under a guardian and a steward, because he doesn't have a free hand because of his immaturity. Although he owns all the inheritance belong to him, although he is master of all, because he is the owner, but since he is immature, he cannot be free. He has to be under a guardian and a steward. So, St. Paul is saying, in the Old Testament, we are spiritually mature, spiritually immature. We were like children. We were like babes. We are not mature enough. Although God promised Abraham that his children and his offspring will be the sons of God, will be the children of God, but they were immature. That's why they were under guardian and under steward. This was the law. So the law served as a guardian and as a steward until the people under the law reach maturity, until they are grown up and reach maturity in Christ. So, before Christ, we were immature, we were children, that's why we were slaves, like slaves, although we are the owner, we are the master of all. Verse 2, but is under guardians and steward until the time appointed by the Father. Guardian and steward. The guardian is the one who guards the inheritance of this child legally until he is mature, in order to behave freely in his inheritance. And a steward usually is the teacher, the person who disciplines the child, the person who raises the child. That's the steward. So the guardian is the legal guard of the inheritance, and the steward is the one who is teaching this child and raising him up. And actually, this was the purpose of the law. Through the ceremonials and the rites of the Old Testament, the law kept our right in inheritance by following the purification and the justification and keeping all the feasts of the Old Testament, etc. And also, the other part of the Old Testament or of the law was to discipline us morally and to help us to grow and to reach maturity in the Lord Jesus Christ. Why in the Old Testament we were considered spiritually immature? For many reasons. We were considered spiritually immature because we could not see beyond the earthly realm, or our mind was thinking about the earthly realm only. We couldn't look beyond the earthly realm into the spiritual realm and the heavenly realm. That is very first reason. Also, because of our spiritual immaturity, we lacked what we call discretion. How to distinguish between what's right and what's wrong. We couldn't actually know what's beneficial for us or what is not beneficial for us. We couldn't say with St. Paul, for example, all things are lawful, but not all things be fed. That's why the purpose of the law is to teach us this is proper, this is improper, because we were not able to make this decision by ourselves. That's why in the Old Testament, before Christ, we needed to be under guardian and steward, and this was the law. And if you think that we are under guardian and steward, this means we were not free. We're like in bondage, like the slaves. I'm not free as a mature son or a mature child. That's why there is a guardian and there is a steward upon me. So we were under bondage. So the law actually put us under bondage. So St. Paul said, but is under guardian and stewards until the time appointed by the Father. So the Father sets a time in which we become spiritually mature. This time is what St. Paul described in the same chapter by the fullness of time. The fullness of time. God appointed the time in which He will send His Son to the world in order to redeem us from this bondage and in order to give us the right to be children and to give us the full adoption as children of God. And as the biological father knows when is the right time for his children to be mature and to have full responsibility and to take care of their inheritance. For example, the law say 21 years. So this considered, you know, an age of maturity. In the same way, God appointed the time of the incarnation of Christ to be the time of our spiritual maturity. At this time, we can look beyond the earthly realm to the spiritual realm, and also we can, through our faith in Christ, we can have this virtue of discretion to be able to distinguish between what's right and what's wrong. Verse 3. Even so, we, when we were children, were in bondage under the elements of the world. So St. Paul is saying, we, when we were children in the Old Testament, we were in bondage. In bondage. We were not free under the law. Under the elements of the world. What St. Paul is meaning here or referring to by using under the elements of the world? Actually, he is describing the law here. And how the law, we can refer to the law by the elements of the world. Because the law is something actually material and earthly. For example, the purification. Do you think the sacrifices and purification can justify us? Do you think that when we offer a sacrifice, this sacrifice, the animal sacrifice, can redeem me from my sins? Absolutely not. The blood of the animals cannot redeem me from my sins. So all these sacrifices and purification can only purify me externally, but cannot purify me internally. That's why all the prophets and all the righteous people in the Old Testament, none of them were justified by these sacrifices. All these things are earthly practices which are simple for a heavenly practices later on. That's why St. Paul described the practices of the law by the elements of the world. Circumcision. Circumcision cannot make me enter into a covenant with God. Circumcision just is a symbol for baptism. But baptism is totally different. Baptism, the Holy Spirit descend upon the waters of baptism. And through baptism in water and spirit, actually I become the Son of God. So here when we speak about baptism, we are speaking about a heavenly practice. That's why we describe it as a sacrament, because we receive a grace, heavenly grace, through this practice. But when we speak about circumcision, this is a symbol, an earthly practice, cannot reach beyond the external purification or the purification from outside. The law, another thing, the law may restrain evil, but it does not deliver us from sin. The law will tell me, do not steal, do not lie, do not bear false witness. But maybe from within, I'm still in bondage to stealing, to lying. I wish that I have the opportunity to steal. And maybe I'm afraid to steal because of the punishment of the law, because of the curse of the law. So the law just serving to restrain me from sin. But in the New Testament, the commandment of God does not restrain me only from sin, but it sets me free from the bondage of sin. So the person actually hates the sin. Through the grace of God, you can deliver from the bondage of sin. The law was incapable of delivering me from the bondage of sin, but the law served only in restraining me from evil. That's why St. Paul described the law as the elements of the world. Also, the law dealt with external matters as meat, drink, places, times, cleansing, sacrifices. This is clean animal, this is unclean animal. Eat this and not, don't eat this. But in the New Testament, as the vision that appeared to Peter, the Lord told him, you know, the law was given in the Old Testament to teach you there is something pure and there is something impure. But this external purification, the purification system, meant to teach me or as a sign to help me how to achieve the internal purification, not just the external purification. That's why the Lord said to Peter in this vision, you know, you can eat all things, whatever God makes it pure, don't make it unclear or impure. So all these external matters in the Old Testament were just simple to teach us the concept of pure and impure, clean and unclean, but the real purity is the internal purity, not the external purity. So we can say the law is like the statutes of the government, dealing with purity, purely civil matters, as commerce, inheritance, ولكن, but it does not deal actually with internal purity. That's why St. Paul described the law as the elements of the world, because that's what the law deals with. Verse 4, but when the fullness of the time, the fullness of the time had come, fullness of the time according to the economy of God, that is the time that was appointed by God, that's the time in which God saw that we are ready to take the inheritance, we can now, we can be spiritually mature and can we receive the full adoption. So when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son. God sent forth his son. Means what? Means the son is eternal. The son existed from, before the beginning of the world. The son is eternal like the father. But in the fullness of the time, God sent his son. So he existed before, as we say in the liturgy, O you who was, is, and abides forever. So the son was not created at the fullness of time. He is God. He is begotten from the Father, not created as the creation. God sent forth his son, born of a woman. Definitely every son is born of a woman. But St. Paul here is referring that born of a woman, not from the seed of a man, but not only from a woman. That's why he said born of a woman, to say he only has a biological mother. He was incarnate and became man from the Holy Spirit and from the Virgin Saint Mary. Born under the law. Born, what does mean born under the law? He was born as a Jewish person to fulfill the law on our behalf. That's why during the baptism, his baptism, he said to John the Baptist, we ought to fulfill all righteousness. What righteousness here? The righteousness of the law. So he was born under the law in order to fulfill the law and also to redeem us from the bondage of the law. Verse 5. To redeem those who were under the law, that we might receive the adoption as sons. The word redeem means to pay our debts, to set us free from the curse of the law. The law said, if you break any commandment, you will be cursed. And nobody was able to keep the law, that whole law, without breaking it. That's why everybody was under curse. And Jesus Christ came and who took our curse. He became a curse for us in order to redeem us, to set us free from the curse of the law. So he came in order to redeem those who were under the law from the curse of the law. And thus we can receive adoption and we become children of God. But this verse, St. Paul said, to redeem those who are under the law. Who were under the law? Only the Jewish people, not everybody. The Gentiles were not under the law. So, is redemption on the cross for the Jews only? Or it is for everybody? Did Christ redeem only those who are under the law? Or he redeemed everybody? The Gentiles were not under the law. That's why they were not under the curse of the law. St. Paul is saying, when Christ died on the cross, he redeemed those under the law, the Jews, from the curse of the law. But the Gentiles who were not under the law, actually, they did not receive the promise of Abraham to be children of God. This promise was given only to Abraham and to his descendants. And that's why in the Old Testament, in order to be from the children of God, from the chosen people of God, you have to be of a Jewish descendant. Your parents should be Jewish. Otherwise, you are not his people. You are not his chosen and elected people. That's in the Old Testament. But when Christ came, he made two things. The Jews, he redeemed them from the curse of the law. So those who were under the law, he redeemed them from the curse of the law. Those who did not know God and were serving false gods and idols, the Lord gives them the right to be children of God if they believed him. And he made them equals to the Jews. That's why we read in John, in the Gospel of John, chapter 1, in verse 12, but as many as received him, those who receive him, to them he gives the right to become children of God, to those who believe in his name, who were born not of blood, not of a Jewish descendant, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. So when St. Paul said he to redeem those under the law, he did not exclude the Gentiles, but he was saying, those who were under the law, he redeemed them from the curse of the law. But those who were slaves to Satan, not in the bondage of the law, but they were slaves to Satan because they worship false God, Jesus actually redeemed them from this slavery by giving them the right to be children of God if they believed in Him. So by dying on the cross, He redeemed those who were under the curse of the law and set free those who enslaved to Satan. By putting on Christ in baptism, we become children. How we receive the adoption? How we receive the adoption? It is through the baptism. Because as St. Paul said, when we are baptized, we put on Christ. We become one with Christ, as if there is a marriage between us and Christ. And as we describe the wife to be daughter-in-law to her husband's father, in the same way, we became bride of Christ. So I can use this expression, became daughter-in-law to God the Father. So we became children of God, became daughters, became children, sons of God, through our union with Christ the Son. That's why one of the titles of Jesus Christ is the bridegroom. That is how we receive the adoption. And we receive adoption in baptism. That's why actually, in the church, the non-believers were not allowed to say the Lord's Prayer, Our Father who art in heaven, except after their baptism. Because after baptism, now they are children, and now they have the right to call the Father Abba, and to call Him Our Father who art in heaven. And after baptism, we are chrismated, the holy sacrament of Maron, or chrismation, or confirmation. And through this sacrament, we receive the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of Son, of the Son of God. So the Holy Spirit who dwells in me, because you are the temple of God, and the Holy Spirit abides in you, the Holy Spirit who dwells in me will cry in me and saying, Abba, Father, because He is the Spirit of the Son of God. That's what St. Paul said actually in verse 6. And because you are sons, because you were baptized and became sons of God, God has sent forth the Spirit of His Son into your hearts. You receive the Holy Spirit in chrismation, and the Holy Spirit dwells in your heart, crying out, Abba, Father. So the Holy Spirit reminds us all the time that we are the children of God. When we sin, the Holy Spirit convict me and tell me, you are the children of God, how you commit this sin. When there is opportunity to help others or to do something good, the Holy Spirit cries within me and say to me, you are the children of God, go and help this person. So the Holy Spirit cries all the time within my heart, telling me, I am the Son of God, I am eligible for inheritance. And since we are children, then we are heirs, because the slave cannot inherit. Only the children are eligible for inheritance. So if we are children of God, then we are heirs. So our inheritance is only through the Lord Jesus Christ. And here I have a very important question. How can I inherit the kingdom of God if I'm not baptized, and if I'm not chrismated, and if I did not receive the Spirit of the Son within me? How can I inherit the kingdom of God without marrying Christ in the sacraments of the church? All the sacraments of the church, their purpose is to marry me with Christ. In baptism, I put on Christ. In chrismation, the Holy Spirit, which is the Spirit of the Son, dwells in me. In communion, I abide in Christ and Christ in me. Confession, purify me in order to present me as a chaste and pure virgin for Christ, pure bride for Christ. So how can I receive the inheritance of the inheritance of the kingdom of heaven without the sacraments of the church. Many people argue, but these people are good. These people have good morals. This is the same argument that St. Paul is refuting in Galatians. Because if you say these are good people and have good morals, but they don't believe in Christ or they don't accept the sacraments of the church, then people can be justified by the works. But St. Paul is making all this argument in order to say you cannot be justified without believing in Christ. You cannot justify it without accepting Christ to be your bridegroom and putting on Christ in baptism and receiving the Spirit of God in chrismation and be one with Christ in communion. So, can we be saved by our morals, by our good works? Absolutely not. Otherwise, Christ died on the cross without reason. We cannot be saved only by works without believing in Christ. And that's why those who don't believe in Christ, even if they have good works, they cannot be saved. Verse 7, therefore, you are no longer a slave. You are no longer a slave, but a son. Christ came in the fullness of time and redeemed me. So I'm not under bondage, whether I'm Gentile or a Jewish. If I'm Jewish, he redeemed me from the curse of the law. And if I'm a Gentile, he redeemed me from the slavery to Satan. So now I'm not a slave anymore, but you are a son. And if a son, if you are a son, then an heir of God through Christ. He is the only way. Nobody can come to the Father except through me. He is the only way. He is the true way and only way for life. There is no other way he can save you except the Lord Jesus Christ. So from verse 1 to 7, he explained to them the purpose of the law as a guardian and a steward, and how Christ, when he came in the fullness of time, he set us free from the curse of the law and make us full children, adopted by God and eligible for inheritance. Starting from verse 8, he started to explain to them his worries about them. So he started his argument by saying, verse 8, but then indeed, when you did not know God, you served those which by nature are not gods. St. Paul now is addressing the Galatians and telling them, you are not Jewish, you were Gentiles. So you were not under the law. You were not under the bondage of the law. You were not under the curse of the law, but you were under another bondage. But then indeed, when you did not know God as Gentiles, you served those which by nature are not gods. You served the idols, and you were enslaved to the idols, and considered them your God, although they are not God by nature. In the Divine Liturgy of St. Gregory, we say, as a true light, you have shone upon the lost and the ignorant. The lost refers to the Jews who were lost because they violated the law and they broke the law. And the ignorant referring to the Gentiles, because the Gentiles did not know God. So the Gentiles were not under the law, but this doesn't mean that they were not slaves. They were slaves to false gods because of their ignorance of the true God. Verse 9. But now, after you have known God, but quickly St. Paul corrected himself. He said, or rather, are known by God. What does it mean, after you have known God, or rather, are known by God? It is God actually who invited us to his knowledge. It is God actually who revealed himself to us. It is God who became man in order to reveal to us the mysteries of the God, of God our Father, and the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. It is God who wants to enter into a relationship with me. And then when I accepted to know God, then I have known God. So when St. Paul said, rather are known by God, he is referring to the initiative work of God. He initiated the relationship with us. He invited us to his knowledge. It is God who called us to his knowledge. So, yes, we know God because he called us to his knowledge. But now, after you have known God, or rather are known by God, is it that you turn again to the weak and beggarly elements to which you desire again to be in bondage? So St. Paul is saying, this is very, very strange. God has redeemed the Jews from the slavery of the law and redeemed the Gentiles from the slavery of the false God. And you were not Jewish. Why you want to go back to this weak and beggarly element? Again, St. Paul described the law as the elements of the world in verse 3. In verse 9, he described the law as weak and beggarly elements. Why he described the law as weak and beggarly element? Weak because the law is incapable of justifying me. That's why it's weak. And beggarly because it's poor, cannot set me free, cannot go beyond the external purification. So St. Paul is wondering, you are not Jewish, and Christ has set you free from the slavery of the false gods, from the slavery of Satan. Why you want to go back to this weak and beggarly element of the law, to which you desire again to be bondage? So now, do you want to go from the bondage of the false god to the bondage of the law? God set you free. So they want to turn from the slavery of false God to the slavery of the law. In verse 10, he told them, you observe days and months and season and years. So he's referring here by season, month, days and years, the Jewish day, which does not have any heavenly dimension. They were merely earthly days. For example, Passover doesn't have any heavenly dimension. Passover is the day which they were delivered from the slavery in the land of Egypt. Yes, it is symbol, but for the Gentile, what Passover means? Delivered from Egypt. For us who are Egyptian, what does this feast mean to us? But the days, the Christian days, have actually a heavenly element. When we celebrate resurrection, for example, we are celebrating victory over Satan and the opening of the kingdom of God and the gates of paradise, and how those who were in Hades were transformed into the paradise of joy. When we celebrate the birth of Christ, we are celebrating the our spiritual maturity, the incarnation of Son of God, the fullness of time in which he came to redeem us from the slavery and to give us the right to be sons of God, the right of adoption. So yes, in Christianity, we observe days, months, seasons, and years. But these days are totally different than the Jewish days. The Jewish days are merely earthly days serving only the Jewish people. But the Christian days are not earthly days. The Christian days and feasts and seasons are heavenly seasons and days. So he's telling them, are you going back to these weak elements, these beggarly elements, to these elements of the world, days, season, earthly things, to be under the bondage of the law? After you were in bondage to the false God? Verse 11, I am afraid. Here St. Paul, as a father, start to express his worry about them. I am afraid for you, lest I have labored for you in vain. He said, I am always concerned as your father that all my labor and all my toil with you was in vain. Because after you are free in Christ, you want to enslave yourself to the bondage of the law again. So, did or was all my service for you in vain? Verse 12, brethren, I urge you to become like me, for I became like you. I urge you to become like me, for I became like you. St. Paul here is telling them, I am a Jewish person, because St. Paul was Jewish. But I became like you, in what way? Now I understand that justification is through Christ, not through the works of the law. That's why I'm not seeking justification through the works of the law, although I'm Jewish. And I'm seeking justification through Christ. So I, who from Jewish background, I became like you, like the Gentiles, seeking justification through Christ. So now I'm inviting you, the Gentiles, to become like me, to put the works of the law on the side. Don't seek justification through the works of the law, and just seek justification through your faith in Christ. So become like me, not justified by the works of the law. And I became like you means I was a Jewish under the law, but I now not seeking or not keeping the law as the Gentiles who are not under the law. St. Paul, he told them, this conflict between you and I is not a personal conflict. Because many people sometimes, when there is a conflict or argument about principles, they change this argument into a personal argument. So St. Paul was aware of this manipulation. That's why he was telling to them that I have no conflict, personal conflict with you. You did not injure me, you did not hurt me. I'm not harsh with you now because to revenge for something bad you did with me. Actually, I care about you as a father cares about his children. That's why he told them in verse 12, you have not injured me at all. Don't think that you now I am harsh with you, I'm using this tone of voice with you because you injured me, or I'm taking revenge, or I'm defending myself, or for personal matter. No, the conflict between you and I is not personal matter at all. And then he elaborated more about their love for him and his love for them. He told them in verse 13, you know that because of physical infirmity, I preached the gospel to you at the first. So he told them, we loved one another. I have physical infirmity. Physical infirmity is what St. Paul referred to in his letter to Corinth by the thorn in the flesh, shukat al-jasad. That's the physical infirmity. Most of the scholars said he has disease in his eye, who made excretion with bad smell, which was offensive, and also diminished his vision. So his vision was weak, and there was also these excretions from his eyes with a bad smell. But St. Paul, in spite of his physical infirmity, he made it a point to go and preach them. He did not use his physical infirmity as an excuse not to go and serve them. And this is a sign of love. He told them, you know that because of physical infirmity, I preached the gospel to you at first. And my trial, my disease, which was in my flesh, you did not despise or reject. You did not despise me of this bad smell, or you rejected me because of my disease. But you received me as an angel of God. Your love for me was so great, to the extent that you received me as an angel from God. No, actually, even as Christ Jesus. You received me as Christ Jesus himself, because I am the one who taught you the way of Christ. and the faith in Christ. And actually, you considered my preaching to you as a great blessing. And you told me this, that you enjoyed this blessing and you enjoyed my preaching to you. Verse 15. What then was the blessing you enjoyed? This blessing that you told me about. This blessing that you enjoyed because I preached Christ to you and I taught you the way of salvation. What was it? Was this fake? Were you just lying to me? What was this blessing? What then was the blessing you enjoyed? And St. Paul, in verse 15, he wants to tell them, I don't think you are lying to me. I don't think that you are not sincere. I don't think that you are just politically correct. No. Why? He said, for I bear you witness that, if possible, you would have plucked out your own eyes and given them to me. So this shows that your love for me was so sincere. When you saw that I have this disease in my eye, if it was possible for you, you would pluck out your eyes and give it to me because of my diseased eye. So don't tell me that all this love was fake. So we have no personal conflict. Why now you consider me as an enemy? There is no personal conflict between you and I. Why now you consider me as enemy? Is it because I tell you the truth? That's what he said in verse 16. Have I therefore become your enemy because I tell you the truth? Many times, unfortunately, when we don't like the truth, we turn our teachers who are telling us the truth, we turn them to our enemies. Like Herod and John the Baptist. John the Baptist actually was loved by Herod. We read in the Gospel of St. Luke, Herod loved John the Baptist and he respected him, knowing that he is a holy and righteous man. But when John the Baptist said to Herod, it is unlawful for you to marry your brother's wife, John the Baptist became his enemy. And Herod killed him. Many times when we don't like to hear the truth, we make the person who is telling us the truth our enemy. And we try to gather around ourselves teachers who are telling us what we want to hear. This spiritual disease is what St. Paul described in his letter to Timothy by itching ears, when he said, the time will come in which people who have itching ears means they are allergic to the truth. The truth irritates them. So because of itching ears, they heap up for themselves teachers according to their own desire to tell them what they want to hear. And thus they deviate from the truth into fables and falsehood. That's what happened with the Galatians. He told them, after all this love, now I became your enemy because I tell you the truth. But he tried to find a reason for them. He tried to defend them. He told them, you know what? I know you are sincere, but you were deceived by your false teachers. You have good heart, but you were deceived by the false teachers. Those who are teaching you to return back to the works of the law. That's why in verse 17 he said they, referring to the false teachers, they zealously court you. They court you out of the freedom in Christ to the bondage of the law. And they actually instilling this zeal, which is a wrong zeal in your heart, to be zealous for the law. So they zealously court you, but for no good. So yes, they are being zealously courted by the false teacher. But zeal is good only when for the right cause. Zeal is good only when it is for the right cause. But if this zeal to make me move from my freedom in Christ to retain in bondage in the law, then it's not good. And he told them, these false teachers, they are not zealous for you because they love you or they care about you, but because of their personal gain. They zealously court you, but of no good, for no good. Yes, they want to exclude you that you may be zealous for them. So that's a personal gain. They want you to be their followers. Zealous for them, not for God. You should be zealous for God, not for people. That's why they want to exclude you. To exclude you from your freedom in Christ. To exclude you from my fatherhood to you. They want to exclude you from being the true children of God in Christianity. So, why this zeal was not good? Because they want to bring them back to the falsehood and bondage. They do it for personal gain. They want them to be followers and zealous for them, not for God. And that their deception or their deceit is by excluding them from the fatherhood of St. Paul. They zealously court you, but for no good. Yes, they want to exclude you, but you may be zealous for them. That you may be zealous for them. Verse 18. But it is good to be zealous in a good thing always. St. Paul put here a very important rule. Zeal, the good zeal, should be only for the right cause and for the right reason. It is good to be zealous in a good thing, and not only when I am present with you. So St. Paul is trying to tell them, when I was present with you, you were zealous for God. But now when I left you, you drifted away from God, and now you are zealous for the false teachers. What happened to you? The good zeal should not only be when I am present with you, but also when I am absent from you. For example, if a father or some school teacher or a priest is around his people, and as long as he is around them, they pray and attend the church and go to the Bible study and attend the liturgy, etc. If he's away, then nothing is done. This is not a good zeal. So the good zeal is for the right reason, and it is always whether, you know, our father is present or absent. That is the good zeal, to be for the right reason and also to be in the presence of our fathers as well in their absence. Verse 18, my little children, St. Paul, you want to tell them, I think you are spiritually immature. You are like little children. I understand you were deceived. You don't have this virtue of discretion to distinguish between what's right and wrong. You are my, but you are still my children. Although you consider me as your enemy, but father will never abandon his children. Children may abandon their father, but the father never abandoned his children. My little children, for whom I labor in birth, again until Christ is formed in you. This was a wonderful analogy St. Paul is using here. He told that he described himself or he liked himself to a mother. A mother who is laboring in pain of birth. But she is enduring this pain gladly because of, you know, her son. In the same way St. Paul say, I labor in birth again. Which means all the sufferings that I endured. St. Paul actually in Galatia, when he went there, he suffered a lot from the false teachers. They gave him hard time. But St. Paul endured all this pain and all this suffering gladly because to give birth to them in Christ. And he said, St. Paul here represents the church, our mother. So he said, like the mother put the image of the father in her children, in the same way the church, our mother, put the form of Christ, our father, in us. That's why he is laboring in birth until Christ is formed in you. So St. Paul here represents the church, our mother, that form in us the likeness of our Father, Christ, in us. And this is the purpose of the ministry. Whether we are Sunday school servants or other clergy, our purpose is to make the people in the likeness of Christ. Not in my likeness, not to be like me, but to be in the likeness of Christ. Until the image of Christ is portrayed in them. Until it's Christ is formed in them. And St. Paul, while doing all of this, enduring all this suffering, and the same applies for the church, while the church endures all the suffering for her children, the church is happily enduring all this suffering for the joy that the children of Christ will be born. Verse 20. I would like to be present with you now. He said, I wish that I am with you now. And to change my tone of voice, for I have doubts about you. St. Paul, as a father, he has doubts about them, about their salvation, their zeal, their justification, their theology. That's why he said, I want to leave everything and come to you, to be with you, to make sure that everything is right. And even if I have to change my tone, I will do it in order to put you back on the right track. Change the tone can mean whether to change a tone into a tone of discipline, to be a harsh tone, or to be a kind tone. So I will see which tone that you need in order to bring you back to the truth. And I'm willing to do it, to use whatever tone you need, whether it's a harsh tone or a kind tone, the tone that you need in order to bring you back to the truth. So here the father, or the Sunday school servant, or the clergy, search for the right way to discipline and lead his children into the truth. Starting from verse 21, he made his final argument about whether justification is by law or by the faith in Christ. And he used the law here, the Old Testament. He referred to the law in order to prove to them that Even the law itself says that justification is through Christ, not through the works of the law. So he started verse 21 by saying, tell me, you who desire to be under the law, do you not hear the law? Okay, now you desire to be under the law. That's great. Don't you read the law? Because if you read the law carefully, then you will know that the law cannot justify you. The law only will discipline you and lead you to Christ, but justification is through Christ. Verse 22, for it is written that Abraham had two sons, Ishmael and Isaac. The one by a bondwoman, that's Ishmael, who was born by Hagar, and Hagar was a bondwoman. And the other by a free woman, that's Isaac, who was born by Sarah, the free woman, because Sarah was not a slave like Hagar, or me. But he who was of the bondwoman, was born according to the flesh. Means what? According to the flesh, Hagar was young, Abraham married her, and she gave him son, Ishmael, according to the law of nature. There was no miracle here included. But he of the free woman, Isaac, was born through the promise, not through the nature, not through the law of the nature, not through the flesh. Because Sarah was 90 years old. And according to the law of nature, according to the law of the flesh, she cannot give birth to children. But how she was able to give birth to Isaac? It was through the promise of God. God promised Abraham that through Sarah you will have a son. So we can say that Ishmael is the son of the law of nature. But Isaac is the son of the promise. And St. Paul said in verse 24, which things are symbolic? Ishmael and Isaac are symbols. Symbols of what? For these are the two covenants. The old covenant, which is the law, the works of the law, and the new covenant, which is justification through faith in Christ. So these are the old covenant and the new covenant. Hagar and Ishmael represent the old covenant and was taken on Mount Sinai. And St. Paul made a connection here. The covenant, the old covenant, the law was given on Moses in Mount Sinai. And Mount Sinai was in Egypt, or is in Egypt. And Hagar actually was Egyptian. Hagar was from Egypt. And the law, as he described, gave birth to bondage. And Hagar was under bondage. So Hagar and Ishmael represent the old covenant, the law that was given on Mount Sinai. So he said, the one from Mount Sinai, which gives birth to bondage, which is Hagar. For this Hagar is, Hagar represents Mount Sinai in Arabia. Mount Sinai was in Egypt. And correspond to Jerusalem, which now is, correspond to the earthly Jerusalem, where the temple was, and where the sacrifices, and all the Jewish worship. So Hagar represent Mount Sinai, and represent the earthly Jerusalem, which represent the temple and the all the ritual of Jewish tradition, which now is, and is in bondage with her children. As Hagar and Ishmael were in bondage, in the same way, the Old Covenant and all the children of the Old Covenant, the Jewish people, are in bondage. So that's Hagar. But Sarah represents the New Covenant, heavenly Jerusalem, the covenant of the Christian Church, which is our mother. But verse 26, but the Jerusalem above is free, the heavenly Jerusalem is free, which is the mother of us all. So Sarah was given her son by the promise of God. And now we are given our adoption and our sonship to God by the promise. You don't do anything. Actually, you bring the child who is born, and then he is baptized in the water of baptism, and then now he is justified. That's why we put white clothes on him. Tell me, what did he do to be justified? He didn't do anything, because justification is through promise of God. God promised us, if we believe in him, we are justified. That's why we receive justification through the promise of God. If we believe God, if we accept him, we will be justified through our faith in Christ. And that's how Sarah received her son. So Sarah represents the new covenant, our children. And then, St. Paul made a reference to a verse in Isaiah 54, verse 1. This verse is very, very descriptive of actually Sarah. Sarah was barren. She didn't have children. But Hagar was able to have children. Like the Old Covenant was able to bring children to God, the chosen people, in the Old Testament. But these children were under bondage and spiritually immature. That's why they needed to be redeemed from the law and from the curse of the law. But the Gentiles, the church of the Gentiles, were barren in the Old Testament. She could not give any children of God. So in the Old Covenant, only the children of God, those were under the law. But all the Gentiles were not considered. So they actually, the church of the Gentiles was considered barren in the Old Testament. And now what happened in the New Testament? The Jewish church, you know, her people are not as many as the Christian who was buried in the Old Covenant. So the New Covenant brought more children to God than the New Covenant, than the Old Covenant. The Christian are more than the Jews. So that's what Isaiah is saying. For it is written, verse 27, for it is written in Isaiah 54, verse 1, rejoice, O barren. Rejoice, O Sarah. Rejoice, O the children, the church of the new covenant, the church of the Gentiles, who were barren in the Old Testament, but now you have many children. Rejoice. You who do not bear, like Sarah, you did not bear in the Old Covenant. Break forth and shout. You who are not in labor, you are not in labor, like Hagar. For the desolate, she was desolate in the Old Testament. All the Gentiles were worshipping false gods, so this was desolate. For the desolate has many more children, now Christian are more, than she who has a husband. Than the church of the Old Covenant who has a husband who is the law. Because the law brought forth to children, you know, but under bondage. So St. Paul is quoting Isaiah here, and he said, didn't you read the law? Didn't you read Isaiah? When he said, rejoice, O barren, who do not bear, break forth and shout, you who are not in labor, for the desolate has many more children than she who has a husband. So the Christian church, who was barren in the Old Testament, now her children are much more than the Jewish church who has a husband in the Lord, and will become sons of God by the promise of God, not by the works of the law. St. Paul said, the false teacher who are teaching you to return back to the law, they are persecuting me, and they are persecuting the Christian. And actually you have to expect this. Why you have to expect this? Because verse 28, now we brethren, as Isaac was, are children of the promise. Are children of the promise. Verse 29, but as he who was born according to the flesh, Ishmael, then persecuted him who was born according to the spirit. So Ishmael was persecuting Isaac. And we read this in Genesis, that Ishmael actually was, you know, dealing harshly with Isaac. That's why Sarah asked Abraham to cast out Hagar and her son. So he said, Ishmael, who represent the Old Covenant, was persecuting Isaac, who represent the New Covenant. That's now. That's why now you should not be surprised when you see the Jews and the non-believers are persecuting the Christian. That's what happened. So he said, even so, it is now. Even so, it is now. But listen, when Ishmael persecuted Isaac, what did God say? Verse 30. Nevertheless, what does the scripture say? You who read the law, what the law said? God said to Abraham, cast out the bondwoman, Hagar, and her son. For the son of the bondwoman, Ishmael, shall not be heir with the son of the free woman. And he said, this is a symbolic. This means, cast out the bond woman and her son. Those who follow the old covenant cannot be justified, cannot be children of God, cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Cast out the bond woman and her son. For the son of the bond woman shall not be heir with the son of the free woman. whether this bondage is to the law or whether this bondage to the false gods. Because many people now, they are not Christian and they worship false gods, whether idols or man-made gods. They make their own god and then they worship them. So all these are under bondage. So unless you are free in Christ and you believe in Christ, you cannot be saved. The children of the bondwoman shall not be heir with the sons of the free woman. And concluded by saying, so then, brethren, we are not children of the bondwoman. Christ has set us free, neither the children of the bondage of the law or the bondage of the false god, but of the free. So enjoy your freedom in Christ. And here, because many people until now, and unfortunately many Christian pastors teach until now that Israel is still the chosen people of God. And here St. Paul in Galatians chapter 4 make it very, very clear. Who are the chosen people of God? Those who believe in Christ. Those who are born not according to the flesh, not according to the blood, not according to the will of man, but they are born of God. Born according to the promise, not according to the law. These are the chosen people of God. Glory be to God forever and ever. Amen.